By saying, we decided to just focus on the knee for this specific talk. We'll not be going into any of the conventional radiography type stuff that you guys obviously know loads about, and oftentimes I think in general much more than most radiologists. So what we are going to focus on are things that we think you guys probably don't see that often, and I think basically we'll be covering the ultrasound of the knee, which I'll be talking about, and then Jennifer will be talking about the MRI and the approach to that. So just to say that, you know, we'll be covering a little bit of physics, and it's more so just to basically understand why we get a certain artifacts that we're dealing with, and that's very important for you guys to know about. We'll talk very briefly about the terminology and what's the good and the bad about being able to do ultrasound. And then I'll just quickly show you guys with a few pictures what the basic knee ultrasound looks like. And then essentially after that, I'll go through a few cases as such, but I'll just be showing you the pictures of the ultrasound that we performed and some cases that I had to actually get from the web itself because we don't see them that often. The reality is, for me, it's more important that you guys, when you go through our imaging that we send you, that you are able to orientate yourself as to what you're looking at and what is normal structures and what is abnormal, and, you know, just to be able to see what the differential for a different type of, knee ultrasound could be. Okay, so just starting off on the physics of this all, basically, this is what the inside of an ultrasound probe looks like, okay? And very importantly for us is the production of the sound wave and the ultrasound. So we've got this little area of backing material over there, which there's a little pulse that runs through there. That then causes this structure over here, which is made of piezoelectric elements, to expand and contract. And that then leads to this transmission of these sound waves that we can see throughout our pictures. It's transmitted into the soft tissue, and then the returning echoes actually give you your picture. Okay, so I'll get back to this just now, but this is part of why it's important to understand this. Okay, very important to, however, remember the following. When we do ultrasounds, you deal with certain strength, ultrasound, and the higher the frequency, the better your resolution is. So these are the probes that we as use in the musculoskeletal part of the thing, and these are the probes that we use for abdominal work. The abdominal work will have a lower frequency, so like 3 to 9 megahertz, and that basically gives you a lot of penetration, but your resolution is very, very poor for small structures. Whereas when you go to the high end, the 13 to 15 megahertz, and we've got a specific probe we call a hockey stick probe that we do just like toes and fingers and small joints with, it really just gives you a 1 or 2 centimeter depth that you're dealing with. And obviously that gives you a higher frequency with much better resolution, but you can't see anything below that level as such. So just to get back to the physics again. So essentially what happens is, let's say this over here would be now some other knee structure that we're dealing with. You've got your, incident waveform that comes in. There's a different type of soft tissue. This may be the skin, it may be a ligament, whatever it is. What then happens is, due to the difference in acoustic impedance, that's basically what you should think that of, is the difference in the, how solid the tissue as such is. You will get certain echoes that are then bounced back and certain that go through. Now, in a perfect world, all ultrasounds will be done exactly at 90 degrees to whatever the structure is. However, as we know, this is not always the possibility. So what then happens is, say this is your ultrasound sitting over here, you've got the incident beam, but it's reflected off. So what happens, instead of all these echoes coming back, you now are reflecting off. This could be, and usually is, a very thick tendinous structure here. And hence you develop a certain type of a artifact, which can cause a lot of trouble for us if you're not aware of this. And it's important for you guys to be aware of this, okay? So this is called anisotropy, okay? So anisotropy is essentially and it's a lot of written stuff here, but let me just explain it to you. It's the dependent on the angle of this incident beam, okay? And as I said, we want this beam to be 90 degrees to the structure that you're imaging. If it comes in at 45 degrees, obviously some of them are bounced off, okay, like that. And by decreasing this angle back to normal, we will then find that there is less of this anisotropy. So when the ultrasound beam is then incident on this fibrillary structure as a tendon, the fibrils may reflect a large amount of these sound beams away from the transducer. And when that occurs, you get a hypoechoic area. Okay, very important to remember that. Now, this is what it looks like. So this is a transverse image through the flexor tendons at the level of the carpal tunnel, okay? On the left over here, you can see this is what a normal carpal tunnel with a flexor tendon should look like. This is the normal flexor tendons with these hyperechoic fibrils within them. However, if you angle your probe incorrectly, this is what they look like all of a sudden. So the same patient, same day, if you incorrectly angle them, you all of a sudden develop like an area of hypoechogenicity. And essentially, if you think about it, when we describe a tear of a tendon, this is exactly what it would look like. You would see just an empty pocket with filled with fluid, and that's exactly what that looks like. And this is all due to anisotropy, okay? This is where it becomes a problem in musculoskeletal ultrasound. So on the left here, we've got the quadriceps tendon that inserts onto the patella over here. This hypoechoic or dark area over here is due to anisotropy in this specific case. The reason being the tendon or the incident beam is like that and then is reflected away, and hence you get this hypoechoic area there. The problem that we've got is that same hypoechoic area we see there, if it is incident correctly, can indicate early signs of tendinosis or softening, if you want to call it that, of the tendon itself. So you have then to correct your angle of the incident beam to make sure that that doesn't happen. Hence, it's very operator dependent and very important that whoever does the ultrasound understands this. This is the greater tuberosity we're dealing with over here on the right. You can see on the left side, there is a hypoechoic area over here. Now this, if you see this the first time around, this is a typical pasta lesion that you see in the supraspinatus. So a partial articular surface tear. This is the cartilage overlying there, that little dark structure there. So this is along the articular surface. It's a partial thickness tear. But once you just correct your beam angle, all of a sudden it disappears. And this patient actually does not have a tear. So what can happen is we can artifactually make up tears or tendinosis in a tendon, and hence therefore cause, you know, incorrect diagnosis is the most important thing. So when you are looking at these images, keep in mind that not all hypoechoic areas in a tendon are necessarily true tendinosis or tears as such, and that these are maybe due to anisotropy. When we're looking at the different artifacts, and similarly, we use anisotropy sometimes in our own advantage, and there are other secondary signs, and it's more the wording I'd like to use here, that we make use of an ultrasound to describe things. So when we are looking at, say, for instance, we've got the gallbladder on the left here, and you can see there's a rounded hyperechoic foci within the gallbladder. Now, the imaging differential for that would include a polyp, a soft tissue mass. But in this specific case, because there is this posterior acoustic shadowing, and that is caused by the fact that your incident beam is bounced back by hard calcium, or in case of bone, it will be the similar situation. You will not see any imaging or hypoechoic region. You will see behind it. And this is a secondary sign that will help you to know that this is a solid structure or calcium as such. So in musculoskeletal work specifically, we see lots of calcium and we see lots of small little fracture lines sometimes, especially at ATFL avulsion injuries of your ankle. And these are the type of imaging you've got to look out for. So you look for a structure with posterior acoustic shadowing, which would indicate that. Similarly, on the opposite side of that, to know if you're looking at a solid or cystic structure, because you can have a very dark lesion that is solid but it doesn't show what we call posterior acoustic enhancement. So you can imagine the incident beam coming through. There is much, it's much quicker in water than what it would be in soft tissue. And hence it has this increased attenuating tissue posteriorly, which we then call enhancement. So if you see any dark structure with this bright or hyperechoic, as we call it, appearance behind it, you know it is most likely a cyst. And very important, once again, with knees, you get lots of cystic structures, lots of solid structures adjacent it. So those are the three artifacts we've got to be aware of. Now, it's very important when we speak about, in radiological terms at least, when you describe something, and especially for the guys writing the exams, and maybe, I don't know if you guys are given ultrasounds to look at, but the long and the short of it is once you start describing something in your oral, it's important to use the correct terminology. So for an ultrasound, we use echogenicity is the first important thing. And if it's bright, as on the left here, it's hyperechoic, H-Y-P-E-R echoic, or hypoechoic. And then when it is the similar, then the surrounding tissue, it's called isoechoic or an anechoic structure if it's completely dark. So in CT scan, we use density. It will be hyperdensity. And in MRI, it will be intensity. So hyperintense, hypointense. And it's very, very important to use the correct terminology so that the either referring physicians or the radiologists understand what you mean by that. Okay, so what are the good things, I think, at least from my side, for ultrasound of the knee specifically? Okay. Most important is that it is a real-time dynamic evaluation. It's great because, for instance, you can do evaluation for trigger fingers, which is really, truly only diagnosed on ultrasound, from an imaging perspective appropriately, according to me, because you can see the tendon, you can see the pulley itself where it gets caught. And during dynamic evaluation, you can then appropriately address that. Lots of people, I suspect in countries with lots of cash will do MRIs for these things. It's not necessary, and ultrasound is more than appropriate for that. Also great is you can obviously have the contralateral side. If you've got one problem of a nerve on the right side of the knee, you have the contralateral side to compare that to. You can use Doppler color flow, which is great. It's not actual contrast that you inject into the patient, but it gives you a definite idea if there's any increased vascularity or inflammation in the surrounding soft tissue. And it's a great tool to help you with infections and inflammatory responses, which we use very often in our rheumatoid type work. Very important is the sonar palpation or the pain of the at the area of the probe. We oftentimes get, just like medial sided knee pain as the imaging, criteria or question. And then what happens is if you can actually palpate with a probe exactly where the area of pain is, you can differentiate between a subacute injury that was there a few weeks ago and acute type tear currently. Very importantly, obviously in the pediatric population, no radiation. So the limiting factor is very important. Your ultrasound is only as good as the operator. And therefore, any reputable radiological practice should have at least either very highly trained sonographers that deal just with MSK work, or they should have MSK fellowship trained radiologists that they can do these type of things, because you've got to really do hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and thousands of these to be able to be sure what is normal and then to be able to do what is the abnormal. So it's technically a challenging, especially the MSK work, to be able to do that. And you've got to do just loads of these at the end of the day. Limited field of view, obviously. So you will just, for instance, focus on the MCL or just the lateral collateral ligaments of the knee. And you don't actually see the bigger picture. There may be masses up higher. There may be marrow signal alteration, which is great in an MRI. You've got all those capabilities. And then probably the biggest problem for us and that we find is that ultrasound knees are now recommended. Please do this scan due to whatever reason. Unfortunately, a large proponent of what we really want to see is inside the knee, i.e. the cartilage, any osteochondral injuries, the cruciate ligaments, and the menisci. And these structures specifically are very poorly depicted on an ultrasound. And therefore, I'm of the opinion that ultrasound of the knee has very specific indications, and for the rest of them, you know, truthfully, the gold standard is an MRI of the knee. Okay, so now just to quickly run through the knee itself, how we do these ultrasounds. So first and foremost, you must be aware that when we describe how we do them, we describe the long axis, which would be along this over here, and then transverse, which is in this position over there. We get the patient in a 30 degree, hence the fact that we don't want that anisotropy problem overlying the distal quadriceps region. And even in this case specifically here, you can see there's a little bit of anisotropy over here. Anyway, so we started with doing the quadriceps tendon. Now, importantly, the quadriceps tendon is obviously made up of a few structures that combine. First and foremost, in the superficial layer number one there, we get the rectus femoris. The second layer is made up of the vastus medialis and vastus lateralis, and the deep portion of this is made up of the vastus intermedius. Okay, we get this prepatellar fat pad, which can sometimes become hyperechoic. You can get some fat pad impingement, the prefemoral fat pad over here, and this is your suprapatellar recess that we see outlined over here. This is the transverse picture of what we're dealing with on the patella, and you can see vastus medialis and lateralis on this side. Then we just shift over to the medial and the lateral aspects of the knee, and as you can see over here, we can assess the medial and the lateral patellofemoral retinacula or ligaments. These are very thin, thready little structures that when you've got, for instance, a patella dislocation, you may say edema in the region of the MPFL. We always assess, we use this LPFL as a, an anatomical mark for ourselves. If we want to do knee injections on under ultrasound, you can see the small little recess here. So we are actually able to guide like a very small little needle into like a sub, this is usually like a millimeter of fluid, and then just without any significant pain to the patient, we do loads of these intra-articular injections for patients with no significant joint effusions as such. Furthermore, you can hyperflex the knee, and then you can assess the cartilage. You're supposed to be you can see like cartilage wear and damage along the trochlea. But once again, it's very limited because you don't actually see the true cartilage outline of the whole knee or the patella itself. Okay. Then we move on to the patella tendon. We start from medial to lateral in a longitudinal fashion. And this is what the typical patella tendon looks like, the proximal patella, distal patella, and Hoffer's fat pad deep to that. And then the transverse appearance of a normal patella tendon itself. Medially, we then slide over and we look at the MCL. The MCL is a very nice structure to assess, obviously, on ultrasound. It runs from quite proximal and then very far distal. There's a whole component of the proximal tibia we don't see here, and then inserts, and where it inserts, you see three little hypoechoic structures, which I'll demonstrate to you just now again. These are two of them, this over here, and then you can make up your mind if you think there's another little area over there. Anyway, the point is these are the pes anserine fibers that come in at 90 degrees to the distal incisional fibers of the medial collateral ligament. So this is where we would assess pes anserine bursitis. As you can see, this structure over here is the medial meniscus. Okay, it's very difficult to assess on an ultrasound, and I'll be describing some structures with it just later. Just to remember, this is your meniscofemoral component of your MCL and your meniscal tibial component. Although you can't distinguish it, that's exactly where they run, and we'll get back to that just now. Laterally, we look at the lateral collateral complex. The easiest of the three to assess is the iliotibial band, and the iliotibial band runs in a linear fashion from left to right, across the street screen there. You can see it inserting onto the tibia over here. And that is the non-articular surface of the lateral femoral condyle, which we'll get back to just now, with some hypoechogenicity adjacent to that. So that's the easiest of the lateral ligaments to assess. Then we get to the fibula collateral. So the fibula collateral is notoriously the most difficult structure of the medial or lateral collateral ligaments to actually, elicit and demonstrate it as such. Firstly, it can have a very tortuous appearance and cause a lot of anisotropy along it. But this is actually a nice example of that. It runs from the, femur to the tibia, across the tibia into the fibula. Deep in here is where you will find your meniscus. And that little structure that we see over there, okay, is essentially your popliteus insertional fibers. So this runs around the corner here and inserts over there. Okay, so we can assess those structures along the lateral aspect. And then lastly, we can look at the biceps femoris where it inserts onto the fibular head on that side. Okay, as we run along the lateral aspect, more posteriorly, very importantly, is to assess the peroneal nerve. When we look at this structure here, over here is the posterior tibial nerve. That is the common peroneal nerve. And this is a typical appearance of what a nerve should look like. We call it a honeycomb appearance. You can think of a honeycomb. It's got like nice little rounded hypoechoic areas with fibrils in between. And it's got a very specific appearance as compared to a tendinous structure. And this is where it runs around the corner of the fibular head along the lower two portions. Then we slide it back onto the patients, then obviously in a prone position at that stage already. And we then look along the medial aspect of the knee where we do a lot of work and specifically looking for Baker cysts itself. So this is the Baker cyst area we're dealing with here, your medial head of your gastrocnemius, your semimembranosus over here. And this is essentially this structure that we're looking at over there, which is your Baker cyst region or bursa. We then go a bit more medially. We sometimes ask them to lift up the leg and then we can assess the neurovascular structures, specifically the nerve, the posterior tibial nerve, then the venous structures, the arterial structures. You can do compression of the vein itself and see if it compresses. There's obviously no thrombus within that area. So that's kind of how we do. We go from anterior, medial, we slide over to lateral, we ask the patient to turn on prone position and then look at the back of the knee. Okay, now I'm going to run through some cases. Basically the history that you see here is exactly the history we are given. So the idea that I would like you to understand is that the more history we get, the better our diagnosis is in these specific cases, because a soft tissue swelling around a part of the knee, as you'll see, has a big differential, and you guys can oftentimes help us differentiate even before starting off if those what we should be looking for. So this is just an interesting case of a patient that came in with knee trauma whilst playing some sport. For some other reason, in this specific case, they asked for an ultrasound of the knee to assess the ligamentous structures. And the first thing we saw on this specific case was the quadriceps tendon that you can see outlined along the top part there, and then deep in the suprapatellar recess there's a fluid level as such. Okay, so we should then be thinking of a hemarthrosis because of layering. And then when we slid over to the, I think it was the medial lateral, I can't remember exactly, we saw this linear hyperechoic structure. And remember, we spoke about this recently, there's some posterior acoustic shadowing, and hence it's a very dense structure. So this could be calcium, or it could be a part of the bony cortex. And in this specific case, this was a small fracture, microtubercular fracture, which wasn't visualized on the x-ray itself. And the ultrasound then, you know, should, and I'll get to some details on that just now, like heighten your interest to know that this is basically a high incidence. If you see a fluid level, and more specifically a lipohemarthrosis, which I'll just demonstrate to you now, you should go and look for a non-visualized occult fracture. Okay, so this is just a case I got from the web. This is typically what you guys will see in trauma, the horizontal beam lateral with a fluid level of the lipohemarthrosis. This is what it would look like on ultrasound. It's actually a three-layered effect as such, the hyperechoic structures over here, and then the sediment in the lower area. So the hyperechoic area is actually the lipid itself, as you can see on the CT scan. The CT scan is dark, the fat, you know, is dark on CT scan. So these are the three layers we're looking at, and this is what it looks like. So you may be lucky and you can get a fat fluid level in the more acute stage, or in a fat fluid level in a latter stage when the serum and the cellular components has actually dispersed between each other. So interesting, I got this little article. I didn't put the reference in there. It's a very small amount of patients that actually looked at, but when you look at the value in the diagnosis of a lipohemarthrosis of the knee, the conventional radiographs in this specific study only picked it up in 55% of the time, whereas the ultrasound of the knee picked it up 97% of the time, okay? Then if you look at the fact that 96% of intra-articular fractures are associated with lipohematosis, one can see that the ultrasound actually plays a very important role in assessing that. Now, saying that, we very rarely see do any ultrasounds on children. And I suspect this is an area one should think of these cases. Maybe if you guys are sitting in trauma somewhere and you've got an ultrasound around and maybe the kid's got a swollen knee, put a probe on then. If you see this fat fluid level, then you have a very, very high likelihood of there's a fracture in this specific case. And obviously you'll do the x-rays after that. Just to talk about anterior knee pain again, patient kicked a ball. So if you remember correctly, this is the quadriceps tendon coming in over there in this fashion. There's however some fluid interspersed. Now remember the following. This is what a normal quadriceps tendon should look like. However, there is some hyperechogenicity there, so that could be tendinosis. And usually this is the early phase of what we see on the left here. And by that I mean is when a patient continues rupturing and causing small little tears there, this will obviously end up being a tear of the quadriceps tendon as we're looking at there. Now, just to run you through the anatomy again, the superficial portion, number one, is the rectus femoris. The deep portion is the number two, which is the vastus medialis and vastus lateralis. And the deep portion, which runs deep here and attaches over here, is the vastus intermedius. So this is essentially the tendon that has come loose at this level. And this is the MRI that confirms this finding. So you can see the deep seated portion of the vastus intermedius is still attached, and the proximal or the superficial portion involving the vastus medialis, lateralis, and rectus femoris has come off there. Okay, so oftentimes find these type of clinical pictures. Patient with a recent fall, specifically, you know, in this case, the hock on a hockey field, 6 weeks ongoing swelling of this knee, not getting any better. So this is the typical appearance of a prepatellar bursitis. So when you see a ultrasound and it's got the soft tissue swelling, this over here is the patella itself. It's a transverse image that we're looking at. And that little fluid level there is how a prepatellar bursitis would look like on an ultrasound. These are two more examples. And these specifically show infrapatellar bursitis as such. So this is along the inferior tibial insertion of the patellar tendon, and you get this dark hypoechoic structure. It's not well defined. It's like an adventitial bursitis as such. So it develops due to this chronic friction. And then the very nice example of the Doppler hyperemia, which confirms your findings, because this, if you get Doppler anyway, it's usually very painful for the patient, and that indicates the pain in this specific case. So what else can we see? We can look at deep-seated Hoffer's fat pad or inferior Hoffer's fat pad bursitis. So this is the patella tendon running from the patella over here to the tibia over here. And in this deep pocket, deep within the Hoffer's fat pad, we've got a bursa, which is very painful. And we oftentimes just inject these under ultrasound guidance in the correct spot. What else is the ultrasound of the anterior knee great for? This is a typical example. If you look from the top, you can see these hypoechoic areas there is a soft tissue laceration. And these hyper HYPER echoic areas in the proximal tendon are small little glass fragments that are stuck in there from a foreign body. So ultrasound is great at looking at foreign bodies. We do lots of work for that to look for thorns, you know, glass pieces, stuff like that. And you can see it very nicely on the high frequency probes. This is a very nice case. I remember a similar case I saw the first time ever in my fellowship, it's typically seen in patients that, play on hard surfaces like these astroturfs. So this is a case of a knee, but it's usually seen around the hip joints. And it was first described in patients that play American football. You know, if the quarterback throws the ball, those guys that jump for the ball and they fall on those hard surfaces, they get this, a very typical appearance of this. on ultrasound, you can actually diagnose this. They usually come into the department a few weeks later with this ongoing non-resolving soft tissue swelling. It's usually not painful. And what we typically find, so this is your vastus medialis, inserting onto the patella there. And then you get superficial to the vastus medialis, a subcutaneous collection, and then the skin surface. So this is a very good example of a Morel Lavely lesion or an internal degloving injury of your soft tissue. So we oftentimes find these over the hip joints themselves, and this is how one would look across the area of the knee specifically. You can see this very well-defined soft tissue structure. It doesn't resolve, it doesn't go away for a long time, and it can cause quite a bit of an anatomical problem for the patient. So that's another diagnosis we can look out for. Now, I'm just going to briefly talk to you about where I think really, along the anterior knee at least, ultrasound comes into its own, and where I would highly recommend using it on a day-to-day basis. So this is a pediatric 12-year-old. It's got the soft tissue swelling and tendonless along this anterior aspect of the knee. So this is the patella itself. You can see there's this bony irregularity over there. The tendon itself is thickened. This is the proximal patella tendon. You can see this area over here is hypoechoic. That is fluid deep to the patella tendon with an Hoffer's fat pad. And potentially over here in this area is a small little tear as such. When we put Doppler on, well, look at that lighting up like a Christmas tree. Lots of inflammation there, lots of tenderness when you press on the probe at that level. And this is what the x-ray looks like. So obviously, those of you that deal more with these type of things would know that the imaging differential on just looking at the x-ray is a bit more, you could probably put in two differentials for this case, but in this specific case, due to the chronicity of the injury, this was diagnosed as a Sinding-Larsson-Johansson syndrome. The other imaging differential on the x-ray, one could potentially think of a patella sleeve avulsion in the acute setting. Okay, so this is brilliant because lots of people will say, well, let's do an MRI for this. You actually just need an ultrasound in a kid and an x-ray, and that you've got the answer. Similarly, now along the inferior aspect, so we're looking at the tibia over here, you've got the patella tendon running there, and you get this cortical irregularity. Now, if you appreciate this area of the tendon over here, it's a little bit hypoechoic, okay? So that means there's some softening and tendinosis in that area, and then once again, you get this bursa deep within the Hoffer's fat pad, okay? This is how it looks like on a Doppler. Lots of inflammation, lots of pain and tenderness for this child. And this is what it looks like on x-ray. So Oscut-Schlatter's disease, definitely. Ultrasound, a brilliant, brilliant tool to use for diagnosis of this. You do not need an MRI to assess this. You can see the mild amount of soft tissue swelling here. You can see that little area of fat there actually correlates to this component, which is fluid, because the fat is darker in Hoffer's fat pad. The true fat is dark, and that is thus fluid. So there are all these subtle little signs that you can look at to confirm your finding. And obviously you guys can just press on there, and that makes it much easier to do to make the diagnosis. So I just want to briefly talk about the medial side. The medial collateral ligaments, as obviously you can see them beautifully. This is a typical picture of a full thickness tear of the proximal aspect of the medial collateral ligament. What's nice, once again, dynamic evaluation, you can cause varus and vulgar stress and cause some opening of that medial joint line. The problem that we've got, that is just the example of this case which was confirmed to be a full thickness proximal MCL tear. You can see all the edema surrounding that area. The problem that we have oftentimes is that your differentiation between a sprain injury and a normal MCL is sometimes very difficult, because oftentimes the proximal aspect of the MCL is very, very hypoechoic due to either a previous injury, most of the times, because lots of people have injured the MCLs before. And therefore, if you've got any pain there, you can call this a sprain injury. But I can tell you the picture on the left can be a normal MCL, and most people look like that. Then a partial tear, unless you actually see some fibers attaching along this proximal aspect here, it's very difficult sometimes to say if it's a partial tear or a full thickness tear. And therefore, I still am of the opinion, because of the related injuries to an MCL injury, an MRI of the knee is oftentimes much more helpful. And then once again, I'd just like to get to the point that this is where your medial meniscus is sitting. And you can see, you can't really see much of that MCL there. So just to remind you that the MCL isn't, just truly this tibial collateral ligament that runs from there proximally to distally onto the tibia. It's made up of three layers, the superficial layer being this purple layer running there, which is a crura. Then your level two layer, which is what we oftentimes refer to as an MCL injury, which actually attaches more proximally to the medial patellofemoral retinaculum. This is an axial cut through the knee, and you can see this is the medial patellofemoral retinaculum. So if you have an injury where it pulls off just the MPFL, your true level two MCL or tibial collateral could just still be intact. So this is an area to be aware of. And then your deep fibers. Remember on the initial discussion, I spoke about your meniscotibial and your meniscofemoral fibers. And these are you can't appreciate the meniscotibial, but it's situated there. And the meniscotibial runs over here, very small little structures over there. So when we describe sprain injuries, specifically more so on an MRIs, we look at these structures to see if they are involved, if they are disrupted, and how far along this complex you can get injuries to. Another patient with medial sided joint swelling. This is however more distally. Remember, this is the proximal aspect of the tendon, this is the distal aspect, and this is the tibia. And remember, we spoke about the duck feet or the Pesance rind. We see lobular hypoechoic structure with posterior acoustic enhancement. So we know this is most likely a cyst, okay? So what are we dealing with here? We are dealing with a Pesance rind bursitis. This is a very extreme example of that. But you can see the sartorius, gracilis, and the semitendinosus fibers on that level. And this gives you a nice indication of where the bursa is situated. Okay, so we can diagnose that quite frequently. We do lots of injections for those. Now, the case of soft tissue swelling, medial side of the knee. So what are we looking at? A hypoechoic lobular structure over here. There's the MCL that runs in that fashion. And this is deep, the medial meniscus to them. Very nice case of a meniscal or a parameniscal cyst, as we would like to call it. Now, I'd like you to appreciate the problem that we sit with in these cases. In this case, you do not see a tear of the medial meniscus. But on the MRI, you see typically what is expected to see in a parameniscal cyst, a horizontal cleavage tear with fluid decompressing from the joint space into the parameniscal area. So this is the problem we've got with an ultrasound. Even if we see these findings, we still haven't elicited the type of meniscal tear, which we know is most likely a horizontal cleavage tear. But this parameniscal cyst can derive from anywhere in the knee. It can dissect from the posterior joint capsule around. So hence, once again, the MRI would be the imaging modality. Now, laterally, briefly, lots of this type of pictures that we'll see in sportsmen. Looks fairly nonspecific, but when you go look closer, you get this fluid-filled structure. This is the non-articular surface of the lateral femoral condyle over here. Okay, so this is the iliotibial band that inserts in this fan-like structure over there. And deep to it, this is where you get your ITB. This is a typical feature of an iliotibial band syndrome. And the hypoechoic fluid there, what I did, you can inject with a little bit of, it's a bursa essentially that forms there. Now along the lateral aspect of the knee, you may get further soft tissue swelling. This is a 55-year-old male with lateral-sided knee pain. So we see this tubular structure. This is the fibula head, okay? And I'm going to tell you that the tibia is over there, okay? This is a longitudinal scan. This is a transverse scan, okay? Hence, we see this tubular structure as a rounded structure. So what is this? Now we go proximally. I told you about the popliteal nerve. So there is a nice example of a popliteal nerve. A typical honeycomb appearance. As we follow it down, you see the popliteal, the common peroneal nerve, sorry, and you see this hypoechoic structure adjacent to it. So what are we dealing with here? We're dealing with a ganglion cyst formation along the common peroneal nerve. A very nice example, which we saw, which you can see on the ultrasound, and then you can see these findings on the MRI, which confirms this. However, you may see a similar structure like this, also a 55-year-old male, just plain swelling around the knee, no pain in this case. But this turned out to be just a normal ganglion cyst between the tibia, fibula, joint space, which you can appreciate over here. Okay, so it can just arise normally from the joint space itself, and once again, can dissect anywhere you want. It doesn't necessarily have to follow the common peroneal nerve. 46-year-old female with lateral-sided knee pain. So we see this hypoechoic structure. Now, in this case, you see echogenic material within this, okay? The problem is that we don't see that much posterior acoustic enhancement, but there is some. So this is like a little bit, is this a very complex cyst? Or is this a soft tissue lesion? But there are other telltale signs. There's these hypoechoic structures that enter along the proximal and the distal aspect of this. And remember, I told you a nerve has a very specific appearance with these thick and fibrillary appearance. So this, we then put ultrasound Doppler on, and you see there's vascularity within it. So obviously a solid lesion and not a complex cyst, because a complex cyst would not have vascularity within it. An MRI was then asked, and we saw a nerve sheath tumor on the common peroneal nerve. The typical target sign that we see on fluid sensitive sequences, you can see the little central dot for a target sign that we more often see with nerve sheath tumors. Another very nice thing about ultrasound is, say for instance, the patient comes in with foot drop and you follow out the peroneal nerve, but you don't see any abnormalities as such of the peroneal nerve. The first and foremost thing you've got to do is go and assess your proximal aspect of your anterior compartment of your calf muscles. Now, on the right, this is what normal musculature should look like. Bit of hypoechogenicity with a fibrillary pattern in between. On the left, you'll see a completely hyperechoic, H-Y-P-E-R echoic, meaning this is now being replaced by fat or fluid. And these are the confirmatory findings. So these are specific what we look for, anatomical areas of involvement that would indicate us as secondary findings that there is a common peroneal nerve neuritis or neuroma or whatever it may be. And you can see this nicely. Look at the amount of fatty infiltration over here compared to normal muscle. And very nicely shown is the denervation edema of the common peroneal nerve innervation of the tibialis anterior there. Okay, so you can see the denervation edema. It's a more long-standing compression of whatever is happening there. And you can see the fatty infiltration. Now we get to the back of the knee. The back of the knee is basically where we do most of our ultrasound work, because this is probably the one area that you do not need to send patients at all for other imaging modality, because the ultrasound is the gold standard. So this is a typical appearance of a patient that arrives at our department. Says he's got a little bit of discomfort along the back of his knee and all of a sudden develops quite severe pain. So most oftentimes they are sent to us for query DVT. Okay, but this is the actual finding we get. We get this lobular structure, we get the medial head of the gastrocnemius over here, and then semimembranosis over here. So this is the typical appearance of a Baker cyst. You can see there's these second septations within them, but that can be seen in chronic cases. And then when we go a little bit distally, this is now into the proximal calf muscle area over here. You see this fluid tracking in this fashion along the course of the fascia between the medial head of the gastrocnemius. So this is a typical appearance of a recently ruptured Baker cyst, which very oftentimes they say is a DVT. So what else can we find there? This is a typical case of a DVT. So you popliteal artery, popliteal vein, and in the popliteal vein, there's this hyperechoic structure. When you press from the top, there is no compression in this vein, and therefore this is the thrombus. So that's the other possibility in the back of the knee. And then the patient arrives, he says he had some soft tissue swelling there, but now the pain is kind of gone downwards into his calf region. Very nice case of what mostly is called a tennis leg. I like the descriptive terminology because it's exactly what happens in these cases. You can appreciate the medial head of the gastrocnemius over here. You can appreciate the soleus deeper to that. And this intervening fascia layer, what we call an ultrasound, is a medial head of gastrocnemius slash soleus distraction injury. And the reason why we developed this, and this is not a typical, this is a calf injury, obviously, this is a calf tear as such. A typical calf tear would involve your distal incisional fibers of your medial head of your gastrocnemius, which is rolled up like this, okay? And you will then see that. In this case, you can see it's got a nice edge to it. So it's actually a different diagnosis completely, because this fasciae in between rips off and is filled with hematoma. And the reason for that is this fast twitch and the slow twitch muscle differences. And it's usually seen in the weekend warriors, you know, guys that don't warm up properly. They jump around in the, you know, the waves quickly, and then the medial head strips off the fascia layer over there. What else we can see in that area is a plantaris tear. A plantaris tear is obviously runs along the course of this fascia layer, the plantaris itself. But once we look at it in transverse, this is what the plantaris tendon looks like. It's just a small little structure like that. But once it gets torn, you see a small little hypoechoic fluid collection, which can look exactly like this. But when you do a transverse scan across this area, so the probe will run like this from the top, from medial to lateral, you will see that this structure is focally, there's just an area of fluid. So that is specifically a plantaris tear. So that's the differential for posterior knee pain. And any ultrasound of the posterior knee should have all these possibilities excluded. And then obviously just another example of a very complex Baker cyst there, you know. However, this is what every radiologist fears in life. And hence you will see, we will always remark on these specific cases that we don't specifically, you know, it's a complex Baker cyst, but we want to be sure that it's been there for a while. The reason being, this is a synovial sarcoma. So now synovial sarcoma can arise exactly at the same region where a Baker cyst arises. It looks exactly the same on an ultrasound. And this is where you can burn yourself very, very badly. You can see this, this is the component which is actually fluid-like on the ultrasound itself, and then this complex soft tissue component. So synovial sarcoma looks very similar to a complex Baker cyst. So be careful of that one. Okay, what else do we see in the back? Posterior tibial nerve with a nerve sheath tumor again. There can be big lymph nodes in the popliteal fossa. This patient had specifically lymphoma. We can see similar structures. So this is, one could maybe say this is a thrombus. However, it's not a thrombus. When you do Doppler, you'll see that this is actually an aneurysm of the popliteal artery itself. And then lastly, sometimes you get a patient with chronic ongoing knee pain. Now, I've told you, you don't see the cruciate ligaments, but you can actually see a portion of the posterior cruciate ligament, just the origin from the tibia whilst it's running up this way. Okay. And what we look for in that specific area is small little ganglion cysts like this that arise adjacent to this PCL structure. And from time to time, we've injected and fenestrated these ganglion cysts, and the patient's pain actually goes away. They've got this nonspecific pain deep in the knee. And for some other reason, these ganglion cysts elicit a large amount of pain for these patients, and they do very well. It can be very tricky because you don't see lots down there. And as you can know, there's obviously lots of vascular structures in the surrounding area. So this is a nice approach to what I like to look at for patients with solid versus cystic lesions. And that's where I think ultrasound plays a very important role. So ultrasound's great to see what the soft tissue swelling is like. And then more importantly for us is to see if it's solid or cyst-like lesion, which then inevitably has to have an MRI after that. Or is it just a true cystic lesion as we're seeing over this? So you'll do your normal plain film, you do your ultrasound, and then you've got a nice criteria which you can look at differently, what the different type of approaches on the MRI could be. Just to quickly get back to the medial side of the knee. So you would say, but why, what about the menisci? So these are not cases that I've seen myself. These are cases that I had to pull off the internet, because on my own, and having done hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of these cases, I can honestly just tell you that I think I've probably seen two cases that I with confidence would have called a meniscal tear. So this is the body of the medial meniscus, okay, running like that. You can appreciate that there is this linear structure going through the body. So that is a horizontal cleavage tear of the body of the medial meniscus. This is the ganglion cyst or the parameniscal cyst adjacent to it. And that's where it dissects from, okay? And you can see the MCL running superficial to it. Now, I've oftentimes seen this. I have very infrequently seen this. And we oftentimes see a case like this where you don't really, in retrospect, you will probably say that there is some linear signal traversing that area. We most of the time just see extrusion of the body of the meniscus, and you see osteophytes, as you see over here. And then we will say that, as you know, the hoop structure, when you look at the meniscus, there's three things that causes a meniscus to extrude. It's firstly a degenerative macerated tear, as you can see in osteoarthritis. Secondly, it is a radial tear of your meniscus. And thirdly, it's either an anterior or a posterior root sleeve tear. So if we see these findings, it's one of those three things that probably causes that. And once again, to confirm that, you unfortunately need an MRI. Okay. So what's the take-home messages? And this is basically the only thing you've got to remember. In pediatrics, it's brilliant ultrasound of the knee for Oscar Schlatter's and Sinding-Larsen, Johansson, things like that. It works very well. You can do the ultrasound. You can do the x-ray. It gives you probe tenderness at the level and Doppler hyperemia, which is very, very good. It's great for the back of the knee, Baker cyst, and the differential of the medial head of gastrocnemius, soleus distraction injuries, the plantaris tear, the DVTs, those type of injuries. It's great for solid versus cystic around the knee, because I've shown you those crazy cases of the synovial sarcoma. I've shown you the ganglion cyst. And, you know, those are the type of things that we want before we even go to MRI to be able to say it is a cystic structure, most likely benign even before the time. Interventional is brilliant. It's a whole other topic where we do loads of these type of things. The gold standard is still the knee MRI, is my opinion, you know. Last but importantly, and this was always said by one of the consultants that taught me my fellowship, and a brilliant guy, and he said, like, remember, if you don't have the appropriate clinical history, you don't know how to guide your own evaluation, and you know exactly what the physician wants. So we really ask that if you guys send these forms, I know it's a little bit extra, just give a good, even if you just say medial side of knee pain, we think it's a ganglion cyst, then already that makes a massive difference for us. And make friends with people with vitamin D deficiencies. That's not us. So we find the more and more, you know, the time where radiologists were just generalists has gone, and more guys are subspecializing, and find yourself a good MSK guy out there and work with them, because these MDT meetings is the way forward to help the patients at the end of the day. Thank you very much.
Brilliant, Ruan, that is fantastic. Maybe before anyone else wants to ask a question, so look, ultrasound is actually a modality we very infrequently use around the knee, just because historically we've been sort of discouraged to do it. Maybe the exception for confirmation of, you know, like superficial injuries like quads tendon tears or patellar tendon tears. So basically, if you would say, look, obviously in the ideal world, it's nice to have everything, but in government, we often limited to access, and in private ones limited by funds. So which cases should we refer? So basically, posterior knee pain with normal x-rays, ultrasound should be a better investigation than an MRI. And injuries or swellings where there's no intra-articular components, so no effusion or synovitis, ultrasound would actually be better, or a first line investigation over MRI.
Absolutely. I think you've basically summed it up precisely. I think the first line investigation for, you know, any posterior knee pain should be an ultrasound, because inevitably common things occur commonly, and we have got lots of osteoarthritis, and they, most of these cases turn out to be a Baker cyst. And if they're not, they're a DVT that's undiagnosed. And then the rarer cases and the more sporty type of people will be those other three that I discussed there. And then similarly, like you said, I think the solid versus cystic is very important. You know, if you don't think it's coming from within the joint, and that's where you guys are obviously so much better, and you guys can distinguish for, you know, essentially for yourselves to make that differentiation, and then send it on as the baseline study, just to know, because we would like to say it's that easy on MRI to always say something is solid. But the problem is, once you get to do with different types of blood within a lesion, that can throw you out as well, you know, and hence an ultrasound is such a quick and efficient way to just say, look, it's a cyst. It is adjacent to the medial aspect of the knee. I can't see it's a meniscal injury, but it's probably, statistically speaking, just a ganglion cyst. And, you know, if this thing doesn't grow in size, you can just leave it at that, I suspect, you know. So in the government setting, that may be the easiest way. In the private setting, from funding, that obviously makes a big difference not to go and spend a lot of money on the MR. Definitely. And then, as I said, very importantly with the kids, those two diagnoses, and we see it so often, it doesn't need anything more than an ultrasound and a guy that actually knows how to put a Doppler on and see that there's inflammation in that area, and then you've got your diagnosis of Oskutschlatter's, you know. So
yeah, that's probably where we underutilize it a lot, also especially in the smaller kids. MRI is a massive undertaking, often needing GA, so we can probably use ultrasound a little bit more. Just one last question out of interest. You know, we always inject without using ultrasound or any guidance. The knee is obviously a superficial joint, and, you know, in our books, quite easy to inject. The shoulder, a bit more difficult. And I mean, there's quite a lot of evidence showing that we're not as good as we think we are with hitting the shoulder without guidance. Do you use ultrasound guidance when you inject knees, or do you inject blindly?
No, so look, I absolutely agree with you. I think an orthopedic, surgeon appropriately trained, you guys are probably 100% as accurate as we would be, okay, with using ultrasound. I only use an ultrasound guidance. The reason, and the most important part for me, is that it is a fairly easily accessible structure, and it's easily, you can teach it yourself fairly easily. And the thing is, it's such a pain-free procedure, actually, because the biggest, and I'm not saying that this is not the case, I did loads of these when I was, doing my internship and comm service, when we had to do those knee injections. The problem is the pain factor in a lot of the patients when they have the ultrasound guided versus the normal. There's without exception, they always say that they can't believe it's the same injection, because you know exactly which spot to go for. You don't have to worry about, if you don't have a joint effusion, as I showed you there, you just have a small little 1 millimeter gap, and you just guide it straight into that area, and you can actually see the fluid going in nicely. So, I mean, surely you guys, and that's the point, is you guys can do it very easily with the way we've always been taught. I just think it's a much less painful procedure.
Okay,
definitely, cool. Yeah, definitely from ultrasound shoulders. Yeah, I must be honest with you. I take my hat off to you guys. You guys have like Yamaguchi level 12 skills, because when I do those bursal injections, that come from some physios and stuff like that, I look at that bursa and it is like 2 millimeters that you'd like guiding for. It's phenomenal what you guys can do. You know, so.
Now, well, I don't think in this shoulder we as good as we think we are. You know, we think we inject the right place, but if you actually look carefully, not necessarily. Is there any other questions? Anyone else have any questions for Ruan?
Ruan, this is Michael Hall speaking. How are you?
Fine, thanks. And you, Michael?
It was a very good talk. Very interesting to actually listen to you talking about ultrasounds of the knee, because we normally, like Marit says, we normally don't really think about it a lot or discuss it a lot. Do you have the fact that you can do dynamic assessments say, in ligaments of the knee during ultrasound. Is that something that you use at all, or do you just basically, take static pictures and then maybe do a Doppler? Do you move the knee at all when you?
Where I do use it is with quadriceps injuries. Okay, if the patient's able to move it, it's not too painful. We oftentimes use that, and we put that bolster underneath to get the 30 degrees, and then we ask the patient to extend and flex the knee a little bit, and that helps enormously to actually see, because it's very in the acute phase when you've got all that blood sitting there between your quadriceps and your patella tendon. It is actually a dog show to know exactly which of the tendons are involved. Now, I showed you these cases which show you the rectus femoris, the vastus intermedius, and the vastus obliquus in between. But in reality, it's even more complex than that, because on the lateral aspect, when you look at the MRI where it inserts onto each other, there's a whole component. So you can have purely just the vastus medialis ripped off on the inner aspect. And truthfully, the way we then do is by assessing the dynamic evaluation, you see the fluid interspersing between those structures, and then you can see that the deep-seated vastus intermedius and the proximal or the superficial of a rectus femoris does not show any fluid movement. So it does help us a lot. I did show that case where the medial side opens up. The problem is it's very difficult, because as you guys know, you actually have to give the probe to a second person, which has to correctly put it on a space, and then you've actually got to open it up and see. So we don't do it that often, but to be honest with you, in our practice, we don't very often time do evaluation of the MCLs and LCLs. They are just for an MRI if the orthopedic surgeon is not happy, if there's intra-articular pathology.
Okay. So basically what we're taking home is mainly for anterior knee issues in pediatric cases, and for posterior, for the popliteal fossa and any masses in that, or swellings in that posterior part of the knee. Okay. Great. Thanks.
Okay, perfect. Maris, do you see Jeni online? Oh, there she is.
I don't have a camera, unfortunately.
Oh, no problem. Perfect. But you can share your screen.
Okay. So I'm just going to...
Sorry, Jen, was there anything you wanted to add from the ultrasound knee part that I didn't touch on? Sorry.
No, I think that was very complete. My screen now, the PowerPoint.
Yes, we can. Perfect. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Jeni Hauptfleisch. I work with Ruan, one of the musculoskeletal radiologists, and I'm going to speak about MRI of the knee. I'm aware of the time of night. I'm also aware I can't see any of you, and to see how many of you are sleeping. And I'm also aware that I have no idea what sort of level of training you're coming in at and which sort of years we're talking to. And I think there's quite a broad spectrum. So I'm going to take a very much approach to a knee MRI. And at the end, we're going to go through pathology. But I think the reason why we're doing this talk is, because I know that generally we'll do the reports on the MRI. But I think it's important for you for two things. One is, you'll get a report from us and you'll look at the report and you want to see what we've described on the MRI. So when we refer to a structure, you want to find it easily. And sometimes what might happen is you might get an MRI and the report isn't through yet, or we even find you get an MRI from another hospital that you don't have the PAC system to, or somebody arrives with a CD, and it just gives you an approach to how to look at an MRI. So that's what we're going to start at. We can't go through all the pathology this evening. There's so much to go to. It could be multiple talks, but this is just quite an overview of MRI. And now at the end, I'm going to try and go through cases and then allow just questions. Or if you have specific questions, I've got a list of cases. So I might even have something that addresses your question. Okay. So something to mention now, when we're looking at MRI, MRI is very different to CT, it's very different to X-rays, and it's even different to ultrasound, because the physics we're using are so different, because you're not worried about density of bone versus fat or bone versus soft tissue. What you're really looking at, and I'm not gonna put you to sleep with physics, is we're not talking about the physics, but it's about atoms. And the atoms we're really interested in are hydrogen atoms, and especially where we find them in relation to fat and water. And so a lot of the things we're looking at and all the structures we're looking at, you've really got to think, what structures have got a lot of fat on them? And so bizarrely, for example, the bone is something that has fat because marrow's got fat. So fat becomes very important. Water is very important. So you think about water in cells, you think about water in effusions, in cysts and in lesions. So that's just something to keep in mind. So it's a very different physics compared to CT and X-ray. And it's all about how these atoms spin. And when the atoms, these hydrogen atoms spin, they give off signal. And that's why we'll often talk about high signal or low signal. High signal is something's bright. Low signal, it means something is dark. And just to kind of remind you, and I don't know how much MRI you've done, when we talk about T2 weighted imaging, we're mostly talking about imaging that has bright signal water, and T1 is low signal water. Both of those, fat is always bright. Okay, we'll come back to that in examples. Then I'm gonna look at some practical issues. And I think this is pretty commonly accepted in the general population, and I'm sure with yourselves in particular, is that there are some contraindications that no matter how badly you may want an MRI is contraindicated. And I would ask for a show of hands now, but that's gonna be difficult to ask what sort of things would prevent us from doing them. So I'm going to tell you. One of the things is a pacemaker. Now you'll be happy to know that that's changing. A lot of pacemakers are now becoming MRI safe, but you have to be aware. So when you send a patient for a pacemaker, you need to ask the patient, do you have a pacemaker? Because if they do, you need to ring us up. And lots of them, if they said they had the pacemaker 10 years ago, it may be unlikely that we can MRI them. If the patient has an MRI safe pacemaker, even if the pacemaker is MRI safe, when that patient comes to our MRI scanner, we need to get a special technician, an MRI technician, who has to use a special magnet to make an MRI safe. So you can't just tick and say MRI safe and book the patient in. So this just requires you being aware of it, making us aware of it, and us liaising to try and find out if we can accommodate your patient. The other contraindication to be aware of is patients who've had aneurysm clips, and I'm particularly referring to cerebral aneurysms. It's not so much a case with aortic aneurysms or other things, except if it's been done in the last 6 weeks, then you need to let us know. But patients who've had surgical clips in their brain, you must please let us know, and in a lot of those cases, I'm afraid, we won't be able to do an MRI. They're just about finding out, and all of these things are changing because the manufacturers know that MRI is a big industry and it's very important that patients have access to them, and so they're doing a lot of work to make their instrumentation MRI safe. And the last thing is about patient habitus. So when the patient goes into the MRI scanner, the donut, we call a gantry, that doesn't change size or shape. The size we have is the size we have to use. And so if the patient physically cannot fit in the MRI scanner, it's a problem. The good thing is for you, i.e. being orthopedic trainees, is that most of them will be peripheral. So if it's a knee or if it's a wrist, we can generally just put that part of the body in. So feet first, head first, hand first. It becomes a bigger problem, as you can see on this picture on the left over here. If the patient, we need to do an MRI of the hip, for example, and the patient physically doesn't fit within the scanner, there's not a lot we can do. But for knees, luckily for this talk, most patients not a problem. We can put them in feet first. But it's just a making you aware. And as Ruan said, it's all about the conversations. And we always just at the end of a phone call, there's always technicians around who can give you advice. Oh, one other thing to mention, with size is every MRI scanner has a weight limit. So if the patient's large, you could phone up and say, oh, what's the MRI weight limit? You can just find out. Okay. And then the next time we speak about it before we get to MRI is, why do we do MRI? Why is everyone so fixated with MRI and it's the gold standard? I don't know if you're familiar with the term USP, but that's a unique selling point. So we need to think about, what is it that MRI offers that other scans don't offer? For example, ultrasound, CT, and X-ray. Because everyone's very aware that MRI is the most expensive technology, imaging modality we have. So we need to know, why do we what is its use? There's two things really, and again, yeah, it'd be nice to ask you, but we know when we look at CTs, we look at bone, we can see, Ruan just told us how amazingly well you can see tendons. So for example, this is an MRI of the knee, it's a sagittal view. You can see the patella tendon, that I can see really nice, but we can see that on ultrasound. I can see the bone, so here's the femur, here's the tibia, but I could see that on an X-ray or a CT scan. The things we can see on on MRI that are really unique to it is the way that we can see cartilage. So this bright band that surrounds the bone, that's cartilage. And if you think about a CT and an X-ray, how many times have you seen an X-ray and you see a sort of a floating femur above a tibia? And you know they're not floating because you know that there's cartilage between the femur and the tibia. And the other cartilage, which is really important, is the meniscus. And yes, these two little triangles, we're gonna spend a lot of time looking at that later. You don't see them on any, you don't see them on CT, on X-ray. And as Ruan alluded to, you can see a little bit of the outline on an ultrasound, but you won't see the amount of definition that you require. So cartilage is really important. The other thing, so two things really. The second thing is, can you see this bright area within the bone? Now in this sequence, normally I just want bone marrow to be dark. And remember I said that on, I'll tell you this is a teaching way to sequence. If something is bright, that means there's water. And water within a bone means that there's bone marrow edema. And bone marrow edema is a super useful sign that you only see on MRI. You don't see it on CT, on ultrasound, on X-ray, but on MRI, we use it for so much. In your case, we're going to use it a lot for trauma and picking up trauma. It's a very early indicator, for example, for undisplaced fractures, stress fractures. Super helpful in cancer where you're seeing infiltration of marrow edema. So marrow edema. So long story, but the two things to really think about when we're looking at MRI is cartilage and bone marrow edema, because the other stuff, you can get a lot of details, we're going to look at those, but this is kind of the USP. These are the unique features. I won't spend a lot of time on different sequences because the reality is that lots of hospitals use their own sequences and their own collection of sequences. The important thing when you're looking at an MRI of the knee is to make sure you have all three planes. You have a sagittal, axial, and coronal. We predominantly use a sequence called PD FATSAT. FS always stands for FATSAT. That means the fat, to look for fat under the skin, is usually saturated. By that, I mean the signal is suppressed. So that means fat should be dark. Any sequence where fat, look under the skin, is dark, is fat suppressed. And proton density is really a T2 weighted sequence. Some places will use gradient echo. We don't use it routinely, and you can use different combinations. But just become familiar where you're working with the sequences they use. And most people use a combination of 4 or 5. Okay, so we're gonna look at the cartilage. The first thing to speak about is the medial and the lateral meniscus. And I'm sure you know your anatomy far better than I do. But just a reminder, you have the medial meniscus and the lateral meniscus. The medial is always larger than the lateral one. And sometimes I find that helpful just when I'm getting orientated with the knee. And they are semicircular with attachments anterior and posterior. We call these attachments the anterior and the posterior root. And for descriptive purposes, we speak about a posterior horn, or we speak about an anterior horn. And some people also describe the meniscus in thirds, anterior, middle, or third. Alternatively, the middle third may be referred to as the body. And that's how, just so that you can understand our reports. But for an MRI purpose, we forget about all that anatomy and we just talk about the bow tie. And this is something you'll often hear described when you're looking at MRIs, is the bow tie appearance of the menisci. So, and so you think, oh, well, that's not really helpful when I'm looking at a coronal image like this one. But when it becomes helpful is when you're looking at a sagittal view. So a sagittal view through the knee, femur, and tibia. And can you see these nice, clean, black triangles, which are referred to as the bow tie? Those are your two menisci. The helpful thing is on most knee sequences that I've come across in numerous hospitals in different countries, the sequences employed all make the meniscus dark. So you're always looking for that black bow tie. Think tuxedo, black bow tie, and you're looking for a nice, clean black bow tie on the lateral view. On the coronal view, it can look a little bit different, but again, you're looking for a crisp black outline triangle of cartilage. We're going to speak about meniscal tears. There are probably three main groups of meniscal tears: the horizontal, the radial, and the vertical or the longitudinal. So the horizontal tear, I think, is by far the most common. This often occurs as a degenerative tear, as a sort of a shearing injury, and it can also happen in trauma. The radial tear, which more commonly occurs at the free edge of the meniscus, usually related to trauma, as is the vertical or longitudinal tear. Okay, so I'm just going to put this up as reference pictures. And I'm going to speak about the meniscus. So imagine this is my meniscus. You can just superimpose it over here or over here. Nice, clean, black outline, full of cartilage. If you see a little white dot in the middle of the cartilage, I'm not really interested in it, and nor are you really. And the reason for that is because if you come in with an arthroscope and there's a little bit of white signal in the disc, which might be a tear beginning to happen or a little bit of degenerative change, you aren't going to see it. You can come with your scope from any angle and you won't see it. And for my purposes, unless the signal extends to the surface, it's not really a tear. It's degenerative change. So the first tear we see is a horizontal tear. So this linear signal hyperintensity is like fluid. And imagine fluid dissecting through that meniscus. And the tear can be any size. It doesn't have to go all the way across. Can be halfway, it can be an angle. For example, this is a very common appearance where you get an inferior surfacing horizontal or oblique tear of the meniscus. And sometimes we'll still call this a horizontal tear even though it looks oblique. So super common, these are the oblique tears. So when you see your meniscus and you see, oh, it's not completely black, you're looking for a signal hyperintensity, bright signal creating a tear. Okay. A radial tear comes at the free edge over here, and it's a little radial tear. And I'll show you another picture just now, which will describe it better. But you see it almost as blunting or truncation or a small vertical line at the free edge, the pointed edge. And lastly, you get the vertical tears. So this is the periphery. Imagine you've got either a medial or a lateral collateral ligament here. And these tears occur in the red zone, which you'll know is the more vascular part of the meniscus. They commonly occur in the red zone, and they can propagate, and a propagating vertical tear will give you a longitudinal tear. So for example, this is an example. I'm now looking down on the meniscus and on the root. This is a propagating vertical tear. So you're looking down on it. It's a long vertical tear along the periphery that's propagating, which gives me a longitudinal tear. The problem with that, if you can imagine, say now you've got this long tear and you're sort of twisting around on your knee. The problem with a longitudinal tear is it can displace. And this then creates what we know as the bucket handle tear. So the bucket handle's been flipped over. You can imagine gripping that bucket and lifting it up. And this then flips into the intercondylar notch. And we'll look at examples of all of these, but I just want to give you some diagrams to get them in your mind. This tear, now remember we said the tears that occur at the free edge are radial tears. So if I just saw a little radial tear at the free edge, that would just be a radial tear. But these can also propagate. And because of the architecture of the collagen and hyaline cartilage, they can often propagate in a curvilinear appearance. And then we call them a parrot beak tear. So that's just a type of tear, sort of a radial or longitudinal tear. And these also can be unstable because they can flip up, and that's why you can get a lock knee. So that flips up, it can create a lock knee. Just some more examples, just to get that picture in your mind of a longitudinal vertical tear causing a bucket handle, a radial tear, or a little complex degenerative radial tear. Now, the one thing to mention is, remember, when you're looking at the MRI, imagine these are cuts of the MRI. It depends where the cut is taken, what it'll look like. So if you're seeing, for example, at this red cut, the whole of the meniscus, you'll see the whole of the meniscus with a little missing part, and that'll be where the tear is. When I talk about the bow tie, so the two bits of the bow tie, that's because I'm cutting it, for example, the green or the yellow bit, where I'm seeing part of the anterior and part of the posterior, and then this gap will be the tear. And this is just reiterating this feature. And this is what I talk about when I talk about a truncated edge. It's a cut-off edge, and that's often a sign of a small radial tear. Another example. Okay, another thing to mention is if we pull off the whole of the root, so if you, for example, most commonly is the posterior root avulsion, what happens is if you move through this MRI, you normally want to see nice black meniscus. But if you come to the edge here where the meniscus is pulled off, can you see now there's a gap? This is a coronal view. If you had to see that on a sagittal view, all of a sudden your black triangle will be missing. We call this a ghost meniscus. So when you work, and I'm going to take you through an MRI, when you go through the MRI and you're missing a meniscus, especially near the root, you need to think of a ghost meniscus, so a full avulsion or a full transection of the meniscus. Bucket handle tears, I've just given you a diagrammatic representation. We'll come to them again in the MRIs, and we look for certain signs, which I'll describe better when we're looking at the MRIs, called double delta sign or double PCL signs. The reason for that is because that fragment is displaced into the intercondylar notch. So this is a fragment be displaced into the intercondylar notch. Okay, cruciate ligaments. Another thing to point out from what Ruan said is you can see a lot of ligaments beautifully on ultrasound, for example, the collateral ligaments and the patella and the femoral ligaments, but you don't see the cruciate ligaments well. The reason being just where they are anatomically, you can't get to them with a probe. So it's not that you can't see ligaments well, just the location, whereas MRI has the advantage of being three-dimensional and cutting all the way through. Anterior cruciate ligament is the ligament most commonly injured, and so really important to know how to assess it because sometimes the tears can be quite subtle. The important thing is in the normal positioning of the MRI, the anterior cruciate ligament should be taut, so really tightly aligned. You see a normal striation pattern. It's really important that you get nice black low signal within the ligament on all sequences. And that the other very important thing is most people just look at the sagittal view. It's really important to look at the coronal, the sagittal, and the axial, because you can look for avulsions from the femoral origin or the tibial insertion. And we'll look at examples in a minute. So this is just a MRI on sagittal view. This is a non-fat saturated, so the fat is bright. It hasn't been suppressed. This is the anterior cruciate ligament. Can you see how beautifully linear it is? It's taut, it's straight. You can also see what I call a striated pattern. So you're seeing lines going through it. But what's super important is that you're seeing this dark band, and it's generally anterior. Now you can sometimes see two bands within the anterior cruciate ligament. Well, there are two bands. You can sometimes distinguish between the posterolateral and the anterior medial band. And you can get isolated tears of one of the bands. This is just to orientate yourselves. You're seeing again, you want to see a nice crisp meniscal angles. You can see how beautifully you can see the cartilage here as a separate layer. Cartilage articulating with cartilage. That's why there's not a gap between the two. And then your medial collateral ligament. And this is your cruciate ligament from a coronal view. The posterior cruciate ligament is less commonly injured and is actually a more difficult ligament to assess, especially with regards to tears. Two important things to remember is the posterior cruciate ligament should be dark on all sequences and should be really well outlined. and it shouldn't measure more than about 7 millimeters. But mainly it's just you wanted to see nice parallel structure. It shouldn't be tapering and it should be low signal. Don't forget your meniscofemoral ligament, your ligament of Humphreys, your ligament of Risberg, anterior and posterior to the posterior cruciate ligament respectively, because sometimes that can be a bit disorientating. Very important ligaments to be aware of, because that can cause lots of pseudo tears and pseudo signs on MRI. So don't forget them. If you've forgotten about them, just check your anatomy box. And this is an example of a cruciate ligament tear. So do you remember the previous one? Nice, taut, black, striated anterior cruciate ligament. Yeah, you can say you can see something. You can see this sort of corrugated, wobbly line, but I've lost my dark line. I've lost my striation pattern. I've lost that taut structure. And this is a torn ligament. It very rarely displaces anterior posterior. It often gets stuck down, but this is a full thickness tear of the posterior of the anterior cruciate ligament. Okay. This is an example of a full thickness tear of the posterior cruciate ligament. So if you weren't aware, you could easily say, oh, but I can still see the posterior cruciate ligament. But what you've lost is you've lost that nice dark black signal. And the other important thing is you've got expansion of the ligament. Okay, the collateral ligament, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on, because I think Ruan spent a lot of time discussing the anatomy of them and them on ultrasound. So I'll come to them when we look at the MRI. But you can, the medial collateral ligament and the posterior collateral ligament. So anatomy as Ruan described. I won't spend, so just cut that a bit shorter just for the sake of time, but we will look at them on the MRI. One thing to note is the grading system for MCL tears or collateral ligament tears is really related to the MRI. It's more difficult to appreciate on other modalities. Grade 1 is intact. Grade 2 is probably the most common. We see a partial thickness tear where the ligament itself is actually intact, it sort of looks intact, but there's a lot of edema around it. And then a full thickness grade 3 tear is, full thickness tear. Okay, so there's still lots of things to discuss. I'm not going to go over different bone marrow edema patterns. There's a lot to discuss on posterior corner injuries, posterior lateral corner injuries, a lot about the soft tissue stuff. But what I want to do is really go through some cases, because I think that's going to highlight things better. So I'm going to come over here. So I'm going to stop share. And then I'm going to... Okay. Can you see the screen I'm sharing now? Can you see the MRI now?
Yes, we can see it. I can see it nicely. Thanks, Jeni.
You've seen the sagittal view now?
I see the sagittal view and I can see you scrolling, yes.
Okay, good. Okay. So I'm going to just take you, this is a normal MRI, and I'm going to take you through it just to give you an orientation and also just tell you my approach to looking at the MRI of the knee. I always start with a sagittal view, and these are the most commonly performed sequences of the MRI. This is a proton density fat saturated image. So you just check for the fat under the skin. I'm just going to show you an example of a different one. For example, this is where there's no fat saturation. So the fat is bright, and we'll come to that. But I'll come back to this one. So fat saturated. So I always start at the medial side. So I start at the medial side. And if you're not sure, scroll through quickly. Find the fibula head. You know the fibula head's lateral side, so go through to the other side. So I always start at the medial side, go right to the edge, come off the meniscus. So this is your medial meniscus, posterior root, anterior root, and you can see the posterior aspect of the medial femoral condyle all the way around. You see this gorgeous light gray cartilage and also the medial tibial plateau. And I work my way through. I come through to the intercondylar notch. The intercondylar notch, I want to see my anterior cruciate ligament running parallel to Blumensatz line, nice striated pattern, some dark signal in it. And then I scroll back, and then I can see my posterior cruciate ligament. Okay. then I'm going to come to the come to the lateral side. So let's come back, intercondylar notch. So come to the lateral side, and this is my lateral meniscus. So posterior horn, anterior horn, and I look at them all the way through until I get to the fibula head and scroll back again. So that's how I start, and I just get myself orientated. And already then you're seeing things. And then while I'm in that sagittal view, I look at my patella tendon, I look at the patella, and importantly, I'm also looking at my articular cartilage. Okay. Then we'll have a look at the coronal view. So the coronal view, I always start posteriorly, so I find my fibula. Okay. So this is lateral side, and it also helps orientate you. Lateral side, medial side, and you can look at your menisci. And on both sides, I take my time to go through the medial side all the way and the lateral side all the way. And remember, you're looking again to see, I'm seeing a nice, clean, black meniscus on both sides, and you can see the cartilage. I mean, you really want to see that cartilage beautifully, and you're looking for any abnormal signal change in the bone. You're looking for holes or defects in the articular cartilage. And remember those images I showed you about meniscal tears. You're looking to see, is this uniform and black? Can I see any linear high signal cutting through those menisci? And then I'm going to show you the cruciate ligament. For example, this is the anterior cruciate ligament. So it can sometimes be a bit difficult to see, but here I'm starting to pick it up, coming anteriorly, and that's the anterior insertion of the anterior cruciate ligament and the posterior cruciate ligament. So you don't always see the whole thing perfectly on one view, and that's why you have to use all three views. And then on the coronal view, this is your lateral collateral ligament. And your posterior collateral, and your lateral, sorry, this is your, what did I say? This is your medial collateral ligament, sorry. This is your lateral collateral ligament, in particular the fibular collateral ligament. And you can also see very nicely at the lateral side, this is your popliteal tendon insertion at the lateral femoral condyle. And then lastly, we'll look at the axial view. Axial view is really important predominantly to look at the patellofemoral joint, but also can be really, really helpful to look at your collateral ligaments. You can follow them all the way down at the lateral aspect on either side and at the medial aspect. You can also, very importantly, is an important place to check is this is the femoral origin of the anterior cruciate ligament. And then lastly, I look at my patellofemoral joint, and this a scan does actually have a little bit of pathology just to keep it interesting. So this is the articular cartilage. And can you see this really clear cleft? So if you imagine on these sequences, fluid is bright. So fluid has actually penetrated into that articular cartilage defect. And that is what we call a partial thickness cleft. You can see even a small single cleft we can see beautifully on MRI. And we can see that the cleft doesn't extend to the articular bone. And there's no subchondral bone changes like subchondral cysts. You can also look at the trochlearticular cartilage over there. So that's just an approach to MRI, and that's how I go through everyone. I try through everyone. I've got I have a checklist, and I go through everything and look at everything. For example, when I look at the axials, I'm also always looking to see, is there a Baker's cyst? So this is this area that Ruan told you about between the medial head of gastrocnemius and semimembranosus tendons. And I can also look at the hamstring tendons coming down. So we'll go through that. Okay, I'm going to get another scan up with some pathology.
Jeni, before you, thank you very much for a good talk. Can you highlight the vessels, the posterior vessels, just so we see them?
Okay, yeah. So this is the vessels over here. So these are the vessels, the popliteal vessels.
Okay. And do you see the common peroneal nerve at all?
Yeah. So here's the peroneal nerve, common peroneal nerve.
Okay, perfect.
If people want to ask while I'm busy, it's probably easier than coming back to scan, so feel free to ask as we go along. I'm just gonna I've just lost my Zoom page.
Maybe Jeni, while you're busy, I'm gonna just make a comment while we're just waiting for you. Your okay. Change of screens. Okay. Jeni, do you look at what do you look for in terms of ACL injuries when you look at indirect signs of an ACL injury? So we obviously, you mentioned the direct signs in terms of the tear through, you know, of the ligament, but what are indirect signs that you look at to make sure that you're not missing an ACL injury?
I think I've got a nice example just in a little bit.
Okay, perfect.
One of the most important things is to always look at the axial view because people forget to look there. And so you can get what they call ghosting, where you don't see the ligament inserting at the, I'll just show you on this one. Can you still see my MRI screen? Can you see the screen?
Yes,
showing?
Yes, we can see it nicely, and we can see you scrolling. Thanks.
So for example, this is the anterior cruciate ligament attaching over here. If you don't see the ligament here, and you just see fluid, and you see fluid all the way, then that ligament is torn. So if the ligament is not attaching over here, because sometimes it gets stuck and can get fibrosed, but if you're looking to see that, you see the ligament, especially in the intercondylar notch on the axial views. That's our form. Okay, so this patient, I'm just going to take you through, and I'm going to scroll through just so you can have a look at it. And it's got a, this is not a complex one, so it's just one main pathology, and I want you to have a look. So we'll go through. This is the medial side. Remember, I don't see my fibula head. I'm going to scroll through. Coming to the intercondylar notch, going out to the lateral side. Okay, so if somebody saw some pathology, I'm going to bring this to this slice. So when we look at the medial meniscus, this is what we want to look like the anterior horn, nice and clean and black. But that posterior horn of the medial meniscus has got this linear signal hyperintensity that is extending to the infraarticular surface. So that's a horizontal tear, and most likely sort of a degenerate tear. And the other thing you can see next to it is this small little hyperintense bubble. So remember, fluid is bright on these sequences. So that's a little parameniscal cyst, which is a little bit loculated. That's just a really nice example. Most common site for a horizontal tear would be the posterior horn of the medial meniscus. And then you can see it over here. It would look exactly the same if it was on the lateral meniscus. And it would look exactly the same as anterior. Far less common to get them anteriorly, but every now and then we do see them. You can see on this patient, the anterior cruciate ligament looks fine, nice and taut. And you can see that striated pattern. And you can see the posterior cruciate ligament. And if we come through to the lateral meniscus, clean, black, normal outline of those meniscal triangles. So no lateral meniscal tear. I want to show it to you on the coronal view. So on the coronal view, this is lateral, this is medial. So here's your, this is what I want the meniscus to look like, a nice, clean, black triangle. This is on the medial side. Can you see, it's just like that picture I showed you, that linear line sort of cutting through, cleaving through the medial meniscus, and that's your horizontal tear extending to the inferior articular surface. And if we come, that's anterior, if I come posterior, that's where you see that little parameniscal cyst. So I'm looking posterior, so posterior aspects of the femoral condyles, and that's your parameniscal cyst. And just to show you, as I mentioned show earlier, you can really see those posterior roots nicely, and you want to make sure you can see the insertion of the posterior root of both the medial and the lateral meniscus. Okay. And then, I'm just trying to focus on pathology for sake of time. Your collateral ligaments and everything else are fine. I'm going to show you another example now. Let's do this one first.
Jeni, and just I'd also like to ask one thing around the ACL imaging, and that's probably one place where there's often a discrepancy between what we think we see on the scan, and then the intra-op findings where people think the ACL is intact or partially injured, but then it's completely torn in, you know, during surgery. Why is that?
So do you find people most commonly under or over call it?
Under. So often there's a comment, or even ourselves thinking that there's some fibers intact or it's partially injured, and then intra-op findings is of a complete tear. Michael, do you agree with that?
I do agree with that, yeah, because I think the fact is you've got to stick with the rules that I told you with the anterior cruciate ligament. So this anterior cruciate ligament, for example, if I just, you must see some low signal, and you've got to see a taut tendon ligament, and there must be a sort of some striated pattern with it. If that ligament is buckled or sagging, in the position that we scan these patients on, it shouldn't be that way. So you've got to start being very suspicious. And the other thing is, partial tears of the anterior cruciate ligament are actually rare.
Most
young patients, and I have a couple of times seen single bundle tears. But just saying, you know, so but they're very, yeah, so it's very, very rare. So I generally, sometimes it will say correlate clinically with stability, because if clinically you think it's a tear, and I think it's a partial thickness tear, it's probably going to be a full thickness tear. Let me just take you to an ACL tear now. It's probably the best.
Yes, I'm also going to just, Jeni, yeah, I agree with you, but it's often difficult to actually see the MRI scan and definitely make a call on it, because I think also that the ACL does have an oblique course in the knee, and oftentimes the cuts of the MRI scan don't really go orthogonal through it. So you often call, over call it or under call it. And that's why I think it's quite important to look at the indirect sign, like the bony edema around the ACL, around the, you know, certain areas in the knee, as well as the PCL and how the PCL looks like, because the PCL also changes its form when the ACL is torn.
Sorry,
Jeni, yeah?
Is, and I'm sure you're aware of it better than we are, that there's patterns of injuries. It's very rare that you get an isolated ACL injury without any secondary features. For example,
yes,
you get your injuries. So you get your contusions, your bone contusions. You often get the triads. You'll get collateral ligament injuries with it as well. The new people are all very excited about ramp lesions in the meniscus. Mm. If you get a meniscal ramp lesion, so meniscal capsular disruption, they very commonly associate with ACL tears. So if you're seeing a lot of other things that are making you worried, you need to look very carefully. So this patient, can you see it? So I'm going to, on the MRI, it's going to come around to, that's lateral, so it's medial, it's a bit dark there. So this is the medial side. And I'm going to come back to the meniscus, and I'm just going to get you orientated to get to the ACL. So we come through to the ACL. So I've seen the PCL. So PCL is staying nice and dark, and then I get here. So I'm thinking, oh, what's going on here? So I scroll through it, and I'm out of it. And I go back again to see if I've missed something. And can you see there, if I just freeze here, you can see some of the ACL. There's some darkness here. But what's happened here? You know this is Blumenthal's line. This is where the ACL should be inserting. I've lost that taut striated line. I've got this fuzziness, it's fat, it's high attenuation. I don't have a nice striated pattern. So this is a complete tear of the anterior cruciate ligament. It doesn't matter if there's still stuff in between, that's a complete tear. And if I show you on the coronal view, you can still see, some people say, oh, but I can still see a bit of the anterior cruciate ligament, but you must be able to take it all the way up. And if I come over here to where it should insert at the intercondylar knot, can you see all that fluid over there? So that's using the coronal view. And I can come up to the axial imaging. So I'll just take you through. So that this is lateral, this is medial, and I'm coming up. And this is where the anterior cruciate ligament should insert. And you're getting all this fluid over here. But there is still something. So this ligament hasn't avulsed off the origin. It's more that the ligament has torn in the mid-substance of it. So coming back down to this one, and you can see that's a full thickness tear because I've lost taut, straight, and dark signal. That's what you want to see on every scan. If it's not there, you really want to question it. Every now and then there might be some issue, but on this one, you really want to question it. And here you can see there's some bone contusion, so subchondral bone contusion over on this side on the lateral aspect, getting a pivot shift type injury. And the other thing I want to bring your attention to, if I come back to the lateral view, so the medial side, this is your medial meniscus. It's not the best, that looks better, doesn't it? Yeah. So here's your medial meniscus coming around to the posterior horn. And just over here, can you see this linear signal that's going down to the bottom? So you've got a small medial meniscal tear, which is actually almost like a ramp lesion because it's partially meniscal capsula going into the meniscus. So there's a meniscal tear with the cruciate ligament. And this is a 26-year-old patient, twisting injury. And like I say, most of these patients, there's more than just the ACL ligament injury. So you've got to start looking for other things. So it's ACL, PCL is intact, and then you'll work your way to all the other structures as well. And you want to have a look, very importantly, especially in these patients, to have a look at the collateral ligaments. If we look here, just to illustrate, here's your medial collateral ligament. You can still outline it. It's still dark. There's a little bit of signal change, both deep and superficial to it. So I'd say that's at least a grade 1 bordering on a grade 2 MCL strain. And you can see the medial meniscus tear better. So medial meniscal tear, full thickness anterior cruciate ligament tear, and a grade 1, possibly grade 2 MCL ligament strain. So you're coming in the combination. Okay, let me show you this one. Okay, so sagittal view through a patient. Now this patient has had you see there's metalwork in here. So this patient's actually had a previous anterior cruciate ligament repair. So if they've had anterior cruciate ligament repair, you want to see, it must look exactly the same. You still want to see the anterior cruciate ligament graft as a taut, low signal structure running in its normal orientation, running parallel to Blumenstein's line. So that should be over there. And if I scroll through, I'm seeing the posterior cruciate ligament, I'm scrolling through one way, scrolling the other way, and there's nothing. So this person has ruptured the anterior cruciate ligament graft. So this is a re-rupture, a graft failure. But there's more going on. So let's look at the menisci. So if I come, this is the medial side, so no fibula head, so I know it's the medial side. I come here, and I'm thinking, I can see the anterior horn, that's nice and black. But posteriorly, I'm just not seeing much. It's more than ghosting. If I come all the way, all the way, all the way, now I'm beginning to sort of see something. I'm like, something's very wrong at the posterior horn of the medial meniscus. So where's it gone? Because I look at the notes and it says patient hasn't had, it said previous ACL repair, no previous meniscal injuries. So now I'm looking, because that's why it's helpful to get the history. Because if it said prior meniscectomy, I'd stop looking. So I keep going towards the center, and then I see my PCL, and I see all this black thing sort of below it. And then I can go around to the lateral, coming to the lateral side. I look at my lateral meniscus. Oh, lateral meniscus is lovely. Nice dark triangle, nice dark triangle. I'm not seeing any bright signs going through it. And then look at my coronal image, big effusion, you know, so lots going on over here. So this is where the money's at. I'm going to take you, just going to show you at the lateral side, so I can see nice, clean meniscus. This is the lateral side. You can see the cartilage, everything looks fine. It attaches posteriorly and it attaches anteriorly. But if I come to the medial side, what's this big thing that's flipped in the middle? There's this black thing, I don't know where it's coming from. And I don't see my normal meniscus over here. And I don't see it over there. So this is a bucket handle tear. So this is when you've got this massive tear. It's gone all the way around. That big piece has flipped over and now sits in the intercondylar notch. So that's a bucket handle tear. You should not see meniscal tissue in the intercondylar notch. And so you can see this big flipped fragment, and this can, you know, give rise to locking and all kinds of things. So the patient has had a ACL graft tear and a bucket handle tear of the medial meniscus. So massive trauma. And again, we're a bit worried about the medial collateral ligament. The ligament is contiguous, but there's signal hyperintensity deep to the ligament and superficial. So that's still grade 2 strain. And it's very rare, like I said, to see isolated pathology. Most of these scans, we're seeing a number of things. And so it sort of takes us, it helps us to think about the mechanism of injury. Is it a pivot shift injury? Was it an axial loading injury? And to get some more history about what's going on with these patients. And you can always look at the cartilage and all the other things as well. And see if we look at the axial view, I'm just gonna show you, which is a nice picture here. The lateral side, that's what I'm saying, is this is where you should see the graft going in. There's just fluid over here. So it's just all pulled back and retracted. Okay. I'm going to show you example of, I need to get a different tear. Okay, let me do this one. Okay, so one more, and then we'll have some time for questions. Okay. So this patient also had a recent trauma. We're going to do exactly the same as previously. So this is the medial side. I'm going to start from the side. So I'm looking at the medial meniscus, and I want to see a nice medial meniscus, and I want to see it dividing into two black triangles. So you can see the anterior horn, the posterior horn, you can see the cartilage. As a young patient, because you can still see the remnants of the physis coming to intercondylar notch, posterior cruciate ligament, nice and dark. Oh, something doesn't look right over here. So not again, you can see, I'm looking for that nice dark black signal. I don't see that. And then coming to the lateral meniscus, my fibula head, let's go to the lateral meniscus. So I'm looking for a nice dark lateral meniscus. Something's going on here and coming around the side. So if we look at the lateral meniscus, I was going to show before we run out of time, this little linear signal over here, that is a radial tear. So that's when you get a direct or vertical line. And you can see this bone contusion here. So that's probably because of the direct trauma. It's an axial loading injury, so a small radial tear. And the nice thing is on this patient, you can actually see this as well on the axial view. I'll just quickly flip over. If I show you, if I scroll through the axials, and you see there that I just caught it there, and this is the little radial tear in the meniscus. This one's a nice one because you can correlate, you can see it's that little radial tear in the meniscus. Let's come back here. And also, if you have a vertical peripheral tear, this is what a vertical peripheral tear is. So this is a posterior horn, vertical peripheral tear, and that can propagate all the way around. So this patient, again, complex mechanism because these are often complex, multimodal injuries. You get a radial tear, a vertical tear, and here again, we're not seeing a straight, striated, low signal ACL. This is an ACL tear. Okay, I'm back. Okay, so I think we're sort of out of time. So maybe a couple of minutes for questions if you have any.
Thank you very much. That's fantastic. Can I ask, you mentioned in the ACL signs, the delta sign, and the double PCL and then the delta sign. What is the delta?
Sorry, the delta or the double PCL sign is for the bucket handle tear.
So but I mean, so are those just interchangeable terms? Because I know the term double PCL is delta, just the interchangeable term for double PCL sign.
Yeah, it's the same, yeah.
That, oh, cool, okay. Okay.